Good morning. We're glad everybody is here this morning. Come on in and get a seat. Morning. You may notice we're having just a small amount of technical difficulty this morning with this monitor, so we'll all look this way when we sing this morning. So, all right. We're glad everybody is here today. And we want to welcome those who are watching at home. I know John and Marge are watching at home. Guys, we're going to say hi. Everybody turn around, wave at the camera. Say hi, John and Marge. Marge is here. Hi, John. Marge is, yeah, there we go. John, as you're watching at home, your wife just took all of that applause for herself. So we're allowed to think, no. We miss you, John. We hope you're healing and see you soon. Now for our youth. John and Marge invite us to join them at their house tonight. We're going to have a youth group at their house from 5 to 7. So the youth will get to see John and cheer him up a little bit. So we'll do that this evening. Also this evening at 6:30, we will have dialogues here. We're going to talk today about spiritual formation, holiness, how we live before God as creatures who have been reborn in the light of God's grace. And so we will have dialogue about that 6:30 tonight here at the building. And if you can join us, if you want to join us, that would be great. We've had some very good dialogues. I also want to share with you guys, oh goodness, we didn't put it into the slides. Lucy, I don't know if you can do this. There is in the Dropbox, there's a little video we were going to show, if you know how to do that. Trey, I don't know if you're here, you might help. Or Hans. Hans, can you run back there and help her? There's a video in the Dropbox we wanted to show about some activities we had. Just give me a signal if we get to the point that we can do that. Big thing happening this Wednesday night. This Wednesday night, we have a community outreach. We've been working on it for weeks. We're going to have an outdoor movie. The movie is Sing 2, if you haven't seen it. It's a really funny, animated musical. It's a lot of fun, very clean, family movie. But the point is that we're trying to reach to our community and let our community know that we have got a community of believers here who loves them. And it's simple as that. This is a loving place. And so we have sent a mail out to 1,200 homes that are within a couple miles of the church. They've gotten postcards in the mail. We have got a sign out front. We've been emailing it. It's on Facebook. And so this Wednesday night at 8 p.m., we're inviting our whole community to come out and watch this movie Under the Stars. Now, we don't know if there'll be 150 or 200 people there, or there'll be 1,000. We don't know. The drive-in's closed, so maybe that everybody in the Western Kentucky area says, hey, outdoor movie, let's go. We don't know. But we need you here. We need you here to be an ambassador for Christ, an ambassador for this congregation, to smile and welcome people. We're going to need people. We've got, we're going to cook hot dogs and do cotton candy and popcorn, and we need you here to help with that, to just pass those out and be present. So if you are able in any way, shape, or form to be here Wednesday night, come up here about 7:30 and help us get hot dogs and popcorn and stuff going. Bring chairs and a blanket. Enjoy the movie. You know, bring a friend or a neighbor. It's going to be a great night. Probably wear some bug spray. That's probably going to be something you'll want. And we will see you here. The movie starts at 8. Be here about 7:30 Wednesday night. Were we able to get it in? We weren't. Okay, so I messed up. We were going to show a little video recapping some of the stuff we've done. We'll try and show it at the end of service, at the Shepherd's Blessing, so you guys can see some of the fun stuff that's been going on. I want to thank Trey Shelton and his family for having everybody over last night, doing such a great job with that. We enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun. In July, I know that the Templetons are going to have everybody for something's happening at their house and enjoy the lake, enjoy being out there, probably run around on the boats and swim. And that, I believe it's supposed to be July 23rd. And so we'll look forward to that as well. All right. As we get into worship this morning, I said we're talking about spiritual formation and what we believe about that. And I want to introduce, if you haven't met him already, my good friend Tyson LaFrance, who's our summer intern. Tyson is going to lead us in prayer. Come on up here, Tyson. He's going to lead us in prayer. And I just want to hold Tyson up. He wouldn't want me to do this. But when we talk about spiritual formation, one of the reasons we brought in Tyson this summer is Tyson is involved in the campus ministry at University Church of Christ. And Wes, who's the campus minister, who I would trust with my life, told me you can't get anybody better than Tyson to be a role model and a friend to your teenagers. He is the real deal. He loves the Lord with all of his heart. And so when we talk about spiritual formation, one of the important things is along the way, we all have people we look to. And so I hope some of the young people look to Tyson. I hope Tyson looks to Terrell. I hope that Terrell is looking to Jim and to Glenn and other people. All along the way, we look to people. They can be older. They don't have to be older. But people who step into our life and say, this is what living like Jesus looks like. Now, you're not perfect. I know that. But he's a pretty good guy. And so I'm pretty proud of him. And so Tyson's going to lead us in prayer this morning as we begin.
Let's pray. I pray that you prepare us to receive that everyone here is during service today. We love you and we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Sing aloud to God, let the people shout before his throne. Hallelujah, sing aloud to God, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord.
Water you turn into wine, open the eyes of our blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater,
our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God,
into the darkness you shine,
out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
Our God is greater,
our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
And
what can stand against? Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Our God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise.
It's Kid Power. Test, test.
Good morning. Can you look at your family and tell them good morning? Good morning, family. When I ask you what you think about when you hear the word powerful, what does that make you think about? What is something that's powerful? God is. It's a very good answer. What else is something that's powerful? Did I hear a John Deere tractor? Yes. John Deere tractors are powerful, yes. What is something that every one of us... Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, that's an excellent answer. What's something all of us have that is very powerful? Yes. Yes. What else? Puppies can be very powerful. They can heal you, can't they? They can make you feel better. There's something else all of us have that is, yes, ma'am, yes. Something else I'm thinking of that all of us have, and that's our words. Have you ever thought about your words being powerful? Everybody's words are powerful. You can make someone's day. You can make them feel better. Sometimes you can say something that hurts somebody's feelings. So we have to be really careful with our words. And I've got a book that I want to read you about in Lucas, and his words are. You ready? My favorite. Extremely rude. I tease my friend Lisa for I'm cried. Hurting people's feelings is wrong. To his feet. So right. Red.
Thank you. Better? Doing good deeds made my heart shine. I loved going shopping with Mom to buy food. Holding open doors, good mood. And after we bought my favorite toy and treat, Mom and I helped an old lady cross the street. Hold on to it, sweetheart. I continued to be kind in joy and with glee, watching Dad fall asleep in front of the TV. He was sleeping on the sofa instead of in his bed, so I covered him with a blanket and kissed his forehead. I helped my little sister tie her shoelace. I was glad to see that big smile on her face. Being kind was amazing for everyone's sake, like giving my neighbor a yummy piece of cake. Yeah, it's good to help your neighbor. Jesus asks us to. I like to help mine with his flowers. It seems like being kind has magical powers. I no longer do mean things like before. I don't tease others, and I don't slam the door. I stopped being selfish, and I share my toys. And I don't shout loud and make a lot of loud noises. Kindness is something everyone can learn. Give to others and ask nothing in return. Helping others is simply the best thing to do. When you are kind, kindness comes back to you. What's something that you could do to show kindness? Yes, what is a way that you would show love? I couldn't hear you, sweetheart.
By asking them to be your friend.
Yes, you can ask someone to be your friend. Yes, thank you. You want me to take that? Thank you. Yes, sir. What's something you do to show kindness?
Being kind to the poor.
Yes. Helping someone that's in need. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, my manners.
What?
She said using my manners.
Oh, I love nice manners. Yes, absolutely. Yes, ma'am.
Helping someone when they're hurt.
Yes, absolutely. Helping someone when they're hurt, whether they've tripped and fallen down, or they're just having kind of a sad day. In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus tells us to treat others the way that we want them to treat us. And I read something the other day that kind of stuck with me, and I want you to really listen for a second, and I want you to remember this, okay? You will never see another person, you will never look in someone's eyes that God doesn't love. Do you know what I mean? You can look at anybody out here, and you may not know all their names, but God does, and he loves all of them. And when you go out and you see strangers, God loves all of them too. Even if they aren't doing really nice things, God still loves them. So I want you to say this with me, okay? You will never look into the eyes of someone that God doesn't love. So does that mean we need to be kind to everyone? Yes, because God asks us to love them just like he does. Thank you so much for listening so nicely. Go be kind.
Out of the mouth of babes. This morning, I want you to stop and let's just think just a minute. The Lord Jesus was with his apostles, and he said, I'm going to make a new covenant with you. And Jesus knew what was going to happen. The apostles didn't have a clue. But Jesus wanted a special way so that we could remember him. And I think what a special way of him just stopping everything, and he said, you'll get your bread. Does everybody have a cup? And he said, guys, this is going to become very special. He said, when you stop to take this bread, I want you to remember that I gave up my life for you. I gave up my body for you. Let's partake of that. And then he said, guys, this wine represents my blood that I'm about to shed for you. I'm going to die for you. I want you to remember that just by doing this, when you come together, take this bread, take this wine, and remember my death until I come again. Let's take the wine. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that we have to share together and remember you, O God. Remember the Lord Jesus, and we want to thank you for the Lord Jesus and all that he's done for us. Father, thank you for forgiveness of our sins. And Father, we look forward to that day when you call us home, where we can be with you forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
My Jesus, my Savior, nor there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, and tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, and may it never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. And my comfort, my shelter, and tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, and may it never cease to worship you.
Shout to the Lord,
all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your wonder.
I sing for joy.
I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you,
forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. Of your hands, forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains, my God.
My God is
mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Oh, I surrender. And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. So I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I have is yours. Again. and I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in all of the ones who gave it all. And I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender. All I have is yours. All I am is yours. One more time. All I am is yours. You may be seated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning, Aaron. Today's reading is Revelation 4. This is the large print version. And this is the description of the throne room of God. After this I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and ruby, a rainbow that shone like an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings and peals of thunder. In front of the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These are the seven spirits of God. Also in front of the throne, there was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the center, around the throne, were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion. The second was like an ox. The third had a face like a man. The fourth was like a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under its wings. Day and night, they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being."
And that is what we have when we contemplate the holiness of God, that all the heavenly hosts bow down and they shout, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Our call as the people of God is to pursue that holiness, and that God is our model, our example, and he sent his Son as a living being, just like you and I here on earth, to show us what a holy human being should look like, the way they should live their lives, the way that we should imitate Jesus. That is our call, and that is what spiritual formation is about. In this sermon, I'll speak about spiritual formation. I'll use the word holiness, but I'm talking about the same thing. To be spiritually formed is to become holy like Jesus. We'll never get there in this lifetime, but it must be our passion. That is our goal, and nothing short of that would be acceptable to us. So the leaders here have written this statement about spiritual formation that I'd like to share with you. God's call into his story is that humans should become like him in character. As creator, he formed us with needs and desires only he can fulfill. As a result, the best version of life each of us can live is one in which we model our character after his. Honesty creates better relationships. Faithfulness builds trust. Gentleness serves the powerless around us. Goodness makes life better for others. Living into the law of God lifts us beyond the anarchy of the fallen creation. But God's call to live as Jesus taught is also the primary form of how we show God our love. Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." We love God by revering him, participating in his church, being honest people, and rejecting oppression, abuse, and violence. We love God by holding our tongues and our anger, giving unmerited forgiveness to others, and preserving sexual union for its intended place, a marital covenant between a man and a woman. By cultivating Christian practice such as these, we participate in creation the way God intended it to be and work toward its full restoration as the kingdom of God. So that is a positive statement about what we understand spiritual formation to be. Outside of that, there are all kinds of negative things that we want to avoid, but our statement emphasizes where we are going. And by knowing where we are going, we know where we are not going. If I tell you we're going to go to Branson, Missouri, as my wife and I took 5 grandkids a couple of weeks ago, we automatically tell you we're not going to the Appalachian Mountains. We won't be in Pigeon Forge. We won't be in... You see, I don't have to give you a long list of places we won't be because I told you where we will be, where we were. So we didn't trick our parents, our kids, and tell them we're going to go to Branson and then fool them and go to the Rocky Mountains. We didn't do that. Why would we want to do that with 5 grandkids and drive all the way out there when Branson is closer? We didn't trick them. We went where we told them we would go. Holiness and the character of God, the integrity of God, that tells us where we're going. And it also tells us where we're not going. I came across this statement recently I wanted to share with you. Sam Pascoe, a scholar, often credited with saying this about Christianity, that Christianity was born in Israel, only to be taken to Greece and morphed into a philosophy. From Greece it was taken to Rome and made into an institution of civil power. Eventually it migrated to Europe, where it was developed into a culture. Later still, it was brought to America and made into an entrepreneurial business enterprise. As much as it pains me, there's a lot of truth in that. A lot of truth in the way that Christianity has evolved. I'm confident that Jesus is not a business to you, to any of us here. But what I would ask is, what is he to you? What is he all about to you? Is Jesus someone that we give an hour a week so that I can check him off my to-do list? Like going to the gym, check. Mowing the grass, check. Getting my morning coffee, check. Going to work, check. Is that what Jesus is? Just a check of things that we've accomplished? Or maybe he's my get out of hell free card. I get to continue living as I want to do, doing all the things that I want to do, going to all the places I want to go, talking with all the language that I want to use. And then I ask God, when I put my head on my pillow at night, to wash me in the blood of Jesus, and I go to sleep with a clean conscience. Is that who he is? He is our Savior. But he is also the Lord of the universe, to whom one day every knee will bow. His incarnation certainly put him on a cross as a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the world. And we all appreciate that and love that. But more than that, He came to us as a model. As Paul wrote in Ephesians 4:19, he came as a model for every human being not to give ourselves over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. He came to tell us not to be that kind of person. He came to show us how God calls us to live. So, spiritual formation, holiness, obedience, values, ethics, morality, that's what we mean when we talk about it. I like the scene in Genesis chapter 3. It's a scary scene. You have God punishing Adam and Eve, bringing a curse upon Satan and upon the earth. And then you have God kicking Adam and Eve out of the garden. And the last verse of that chapter says something about God posting cherubim at the entrance to the garden, and someone wielding a flaming sword, not allowing anybody to come into the garden. See, the garden represents where God is. And because of Adam and Eve's sin, they're not allowed back in the garden. You got to keep a distance from God. Being in God's presence is dangerous under the wrong conditions. Being in God's presence is something that we want more than anything, but if we're not ready to be in His presence, there awaits an angel with a flaming sword to stop us from coming any closer. I can't imagine the heartbreak that must have caused God to have to say, "You don't come any closer." We were created to be in the presence of God. Adam and Eve walking in the cool of the day in the garden, talking to God, arm in arm, hand in hand, with the fellowship being so wonderful and so sweet, so precious, so enjoyable, until sin entered the picture, until the holiness of the garden got interrupted with the unholiness of Adam and Eve's sin. And now stands an angel with a flaming sword. You don't get any closer to God in an unholy lifestyle. It's an image that we would do well to keep in mind. After fearing the presence of God following the Exodus, God demonstrated that He doesn't want His people to be at a distance, so He developed a Levitical system of sacrifices. Sacrifices designed to express thanks to God, to make atonement, to slay an innocent animal, so that we could be closer to God again, because God doesn't want to be away from us. No parent with any kind of value system at all wants his children to be at a distance. We want them close, really close, for an hour or two. We want them really close because we love them. We're passionate about them. Can you imagine how it must have broken the heart of God to have to position an angel with a flaming sword and to post guards there at the entrance to the garden so that humans could not be closer to Him than that? God calls Israel to be holy. It's dangerous to be close, but He wants us close. And the way that we bridge that danger is through holiness, by being the people God calls us to be. Building on the Levitical sacrificial system, the book of Hebrews argues that Jesus is our atoning sacrifice. He is the bridge of holiness that allows us to come into the presence of God. Sin makes us aware of how unholy we are, and that only a blameless sacrifice would make it possible for us to be close to God. So the innocent suffered for the guilty. The blameless suffered for those guilty of blame. And Jesus makes it possible for us to enter the throne room of God and to be close to Him. Jesus' work in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 11 is described as His suffering making it possible for us to be in God's family because Jesus makes us holy. Holiness is how we come into the presence of God without the danger of a head being lopped off by an angel wearing a fiery sword. That's how we get close to our God. I love a passage, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. It may be, today at least, my favorite passage on holiness. It's easy for us to hear the last part, but I want us to hear the whole verse. Listen to this. Therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves. How do we do that? Let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit. Let's get away from everything that is being kept out of the presence of God. Let's get rid of everything the angel stands guarding the presence of God with. Let's get rid of everything that contaminates body and spirit. How do we do that? Perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. We are trying every day to make our holiness perfect. That is, whole, complete. In this lifetime, we won't get there. But that's our passion. It's our passion to become more and more and more like Jesus every day that we live. Holiness is both a present condition and an ongoing process. God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, Paul writes in three different texts that he wrote, the Trinity work together to make us holy. God doesn't want to be separate from us. Jesus doesn't want us to be distant from God. The Holy Spirit doesn't want us to feel powerless. So the Father, the Son, and the Spirit work together to bridge so that we become holy people. Our salvation is through faith, repentance, baptism into Christ. We become a justified people of God. Sanctification, which means to be holy, means that we are progressing in our journey of being perfected. Holiness is more than an attitude. Holiness is an action. It is a way of living. You cannot be holy if you're not living holy. You can't claim to be a holy person if the lifestyle we're portraying is not one of submission to God. We both live in holiness and we are progressively becoming more holy as we become more like Jesus. We have eternal life already, but we don't yet have it. We have holiness already, but not completely. We are aiming for more. When Jesus returns, we will fully recognize the completion of our spiritual formation. We become whole, perfect in the full sense of the word. But we need to hear the call that is in the Bible, the call to become holy people. Every book in the New Testament addresses this in some way. Matthew says that we must pay attention to what Jesus taught. So we have five lengthy sections in the Gospel of Matthew that many scholars understand parallel the five books of the law. And that in these five lengthy sections, Matthew says, this is what Jesus taught, and he calls us to believe and practice these five things. The first of those five sections is the Sermon on the Mount. You read the sermon to find out how holy people live. Mark says, I want you to follow Jesus who is the Son of God and proclaim Him to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. And in that proclamation, we commit to follow Him. To follow Him means we live like Him. We imitate Him. Luke says that the gospel is all about everybody all over the world listening to Jesus whether you're Jew or Gentile or black or white or whatever your culture is, that you listen to Jesus and you commit to Him. And the invitation is open for everybody. And then Luke's second volume, the book of Acts, the early Christians believed what Jesus practiced and taught, and they put it into practice in their own lives in their pursuit of holiness. John's gospel. Oh, John says, the world is the enemy of God. The world is that dark realm that Satan controls. And through the signs and wonders that Jesus performed, he showed how that Jesus is attacking the realm of Satan. And in attacking it, we are finding out that we are children of light, not of darkness. So as children of light, we are not a part of the world. Paul says that Jesus' gospel in the book of Romans is something not to be ashamed of, but something to boldly proclaim in the way that we live. And he says the way that we do this is by becoming slaves to righteousness. That's another way of saying pursue spiritual formation, pursue holiness. We are slaves to doing the right things God tells us to do. First and Second Corinthians tells us that the wisdom that God showed in sending His Son here on this earth shows us how to live out our lives in community with one another as the only legitimate expression of love. God defines for us what love is. The book of Galatians tells us that Jesus is the great equalizer who honors faith wherever it comes from people who are pursuing holiness. The book of Ephesians is a wonderful book that tells us how Jesus is God's agent of redemption and reconciliation and unites the whole world as we learn to turn away from certain kinds of living that the pagans live, because it is in Jesus that we learn how to live. And at one point in Galatians chapter 4, verse 20, Paul looked at the way that he had heard about the Ephesians living their life, and he said, "You didn't learn that from Jesus." So when we act out a certain kind of way, ask ourselves, am I learning this from Jesus or am I learning this from the world? Some things look like Jesus. Some things look like the world. Paul in Ephesians says, compare the two and pursue Jesus. Philippians says that Jesus is the Lord of all things and that every knee will bow before Him one day. So as a result of that, we need to learn to get along with each other. Brothers and sisters need to love each other and work toward unity. Colossians argues that Jesus is above all human philosophies, above all the teachings that anybody else might have. He's above everything that the world might offer, that He is the supreme one behind the cosmos. Jesus makes the cosmos stand, so we obey Him. First and Second Thessalonians is all about when Jesus comes again, that we will be united with Him if we are believers, the ones who have learned not to grieve as other people grieve when we lose a loved one in death, because we know they've gone to be with the Lord. But we also know that when Jesus comes, there will be a fiery ordeal of punishment coming for those who did not pursue holiness. From 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, often called the pastorals, we learn about Paul counseling young men, Timothy and Titus, to preach and to teach and to be faithful regarding what had been passed on to them, because what they had been deposited to teach and preach was what they needed to guard, the truth of how one pursues holiness. Philemon says that the gospel is about treating people fairly. So Philemon was ordered by Paul to accept his runaway slave Onesimus back and to love him and treat him as if he were treating Paul that way. Then we have Hebrews that argues that the Son of God, Jesus Christ, prioritizes the assembly of God's people coming together. Even Jesus is portrayed in Hebrews chapter 2 as coming into the assembly and singing praises to God. Well, if Jesus prioritizes that, His people prioritize the same thing, because we know that no one will see the Lord without holiness. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 14 says. And then when we get to other texts in Scripture, for example, the Gospel of John, Jesus demands, James. James demands in chapter 1 and verse 27 that the weak and the suffering need to be recognized by people of God and to work with them, alongside them, to keep them blessed and cared for. Because James says the call of a Christian is to keep ourselves unpolluted from the world, to not be contaminated by what the world says, because we don't live by the world. We keep ourselves unspotted from the world. First Peter argues that we're God's holy people, called to practice the Christian virtues in Second Peter as they are listed. So we interact with political powers, the values that we practice at work, the way that we treat our spouses and our families, that we suffer with dignity, even as Jesus did. That's what it means to be holy. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John argue that we're beloved children of God who prioritize the truths about Jesus Christ, and we live as He did, and we are not of the world. We get our identity as children of God. Jude argues that we don't fall into rebellion as a lot of others did, but that we faithfully contend for the faith which has once for all been delivered to the saints. And we don't compromise that faith. And Jude gives a long list of people who did compromise the faith and what happened to them. We don't pursue that way. The book of Revelation portrays people of holiness as people who follow the rider on the white horse, Jesus Christ. I want to talk just a minute about Ephesians. The book of Ephesians divides into two sections. The first half is easily seen because, with one exception, there are statements. It's called indicatives, just declarative statements, that God should be praised because He chose us. Jesus redeemed us. The Spirit seals us and sanctifies us, guarantees that our salvation is secure. And through what happened in Jesus, God has made us His creation. And Jesus is working to unite the whole world into one body in Him. Because of everything Jesus has done, Paul gives 40 commands. Now, as I read those 40 commands, I have to tell you, they are imperatives. Imperatives are not optional. Statements of what God has done are followed by imperatives for how we have to live. Paul loves to write in that format. You find it again and again and again in his letters. God did this, it demands this of us. They aren't suggestions. I don't have to be kind when I feel like it. I should be kind all of the time. I don't love my wife or my husband or my children just when I feel like it. I do it all of the time. I don't use good language when I'm under control. I use good language when I'm about to lose control. Those are the commands that you find in Scripture in Ephesians. Those are the imperatives. Those identify the way of holiness. And it's not just there that we find that in Ephesians. 1 Thessalonians says that we prioritize our relationships. Specifically, chapter 4 is about the way that we live sexually in our world. So chapter 4 says that outside the context of marriage between a husband and wife, that you don't go out and live sexually however you choose to live. That in a dating relationship, sex is not for dating. Dating is not for sex. Paul makes that clear in 1 Thessalonians 4. That we treat one another with holiness. And that is defined as a relationship between a husband and a wife. Only there. Hear Scripture. Any kind of sexual activity outside of the covenant of marriage between a husband and wife is unholy. It is unacceptable. It is off course of what we're called to be and to do. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, John says that we should not love the world, nor any of the things in the world. For everything that's in the world, the lust of flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, they're not from God. So we don't allow our flesh, our eyes, things we desire, we don't allow those things to define what we will do. You know, there are a lot of things in my life, quite honestly, that God wants me to do that I don't want to do them. I could give you a long list. Let me give you one of them. I don't want to go to somebody and apologize to them for something stupid I did. I don't want to do that. But I do it a lot. Nor do I want to go to somebody and tell them they owe me an apology for something stupid they did. Boy, that one's really hard. But did you know the same scripture says that both are to be done? People on the route of holiness, of spiritual formation, prioritize both of those. Why? Because relationships are important. I'd rather not do those. They're hard. Really hard. When I was 18, I didn't want to control myself in a whole lot of ways. I haven't found 65 to be completely sheltered from those things, because I still want to do some of those things. The desire is still there. But when I am committed to living a holy life, my desire to be holy is stronger than my desire to listen to those things. It has to be stronger. It has to be passionate. And let me tell you, the key to controlling all of those desires is that your desire for holiness has to be stronger. It has to be stronger. It has to be paramount to everything else that we see or do or want. Nobody gets to define right and wrong for me but Jesus Christ. Nobody. That'd be a good place to say amen. Nobody gets to define right and wrong for me but Jesus Christ. That is what the scripture teaches. The question is, am I sold out to that? Because it's only in being sold out to that that I will be spiritually formed in the way of holiness. Oh, I'll make mistakes. We will all make mistakes. But am I sold out to pursuing holiness? Leah Church loves basketball. That happens to be her real last name. When she made it to the University of North Carolina, standing on that court playing college basketball on a scholarship, she realized, this is where Michael Jordan played. I'm playing basketball on the court where Jordan got his launch. And she was so excited about playing basketball. Her first couple of years there were wonderful. The coaching environment, the people she worked with were great. There were only two Christians on the team, her and one other girl. But she was respected for her beliefs until a coaching situation changed. A new coach comes in, a new coaching staff. And Leah began to find it very difficult to be a Christian. She was ridiculed, joked at, tempted, pushed, persecuted because of her faith. Her closest friend, the other Christian that she played with on that team, finally had enough, and now Leah's alone. And when the new coaching staff decided that he would insist that the entire team would support causes that Leah could not support, she could not act like she was in favor of causes that she was not in favor of. I don't know about you. I've struggled with this a lot in past recent years, but a whole lot more recently. I'm a gun owner. I enjoy shooting guns. Man, am I hating what I'm seeing people do with them. I'm struggling. I'm having to back up a little bit and say, you know, I don't own an AR-15. I'm not going to own one. If you own one, that's fine. I have no problem with that. I'm not going to own one. And there's some other things that I'm not going to do. I'm a life member of the NRA. I'm really backing off and reconsidering that. I'm struggling with this hard position that won't budge for anything. Leah talked to her mom and her dad. They prayed, and she resigned. Walked off the court. She had dreamed of playing on her whole life because she said, I cannot stand for what this group now stands for. Franklin Graham compared Leah to the Old Testament Daniel, who had to take a stand of what he would and would not do. And for Daniel, the decision was easy because his passion was holiness. Leah models what it means to be a holy person. The Iron Man of the NBA understands Leah's struggles. Leah quit in 2020. The Iron Man of the NBA managed to play NBA basketball for 15 seasons. 15 years laughed at, joked at, ridiculed, tempted, with his teammates sending women to his room, trying to do everything they could with booze and alcohol and drugs to get him to compromise his faith. But A.C. Green lived until he was 38 years old as a virgin because his passion for Jesus Christ was stronger than anything else, and he absolutely refused to compromise that. And when he married Veronica, he gave her the most precious gift that he could give her, something no other woman had seen or touched or interacted with. By the way, they're still married. When you do it God's way, it tends to reinforce the covenant that God calls us to live into as husbands and wives. One of A.C. Green's teammates, Anthony Mason, said that if you were to be around A.C. Green, you would think he's kind of a goody two-shoes, that he's not the real deal. But Mason's life began falling apart because he didn't live a life of holiness at all. And he began to see the mistakes he had made and became more and more drawn to A.C. Green. And he said, let me tell you what, A.C. Green is the real deal. A.C. Green is living his life the way God meant for lives to be lived. It wasn't easy. There were a lot of things that would tempt over the years. But anyone who can live 15 years in the NBA, where sex is free, where drugs is free, where alcohol is there, all that you want, and not even one time in his three NBA championships did A.C. Green crack the bottle of a champagne glass, a bottle, and spray it for the cameras. He wasn't a goody two-shoes. He was and is the real deal. We are called to be holy people. As Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 7:1, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. That's why we're holy, because God is holy and we love Him. We're devoted to Him. We're so crazy about our God that whatever He wants, we want it. It is of paramount importance. Aylin Miller has decided to be baptized this morning. She is giving her way, her life, to the way of holiness. They are preparing for this right now, and I think are ready to go ahead and be baptized. And Joshua, after the baptism, we'll have this other song. And during that song, if any of you would like to join Aylin's example, you could come forward and talk to us about it. We'd love to participate in a new birth for you, even as we participate in Aylin's new birth.
spiritual formation, we're about to see the beginning of that process. We've been talking a lot in the youth group and in the youth group class about what it means and what it looks like to become Christ's. And this moment that we're all about to witness is a moment where the flesh, the false self, dies. We get buried in a grave with Jesus and raised up to new life. Now, when Ayla and I were talking this morning, she said, well, I'm just a little bit nervous because, you know, what happens if I mess up, if I go down the wrong path? And we talked about the prodigal son, that we serve a God who comes running, right? So I just want to, for those of you here today, and Aylin, I want you to look out. For those of you here today who've been baptized, how many of you have been baptized and then since have sinned? Okay. How many of you have been baptized and sinned more than once since then? How many of you have been baptized and you sinned within the last week? And how many of you does God still love? God's love is not conditional upon our behavior. And that's one of the things that gets lost in this talk about spiritual formation sometimes, is sometimes it can feel like, well, if I'm not formed into the shape of Christ, then he'll stop loving me. Oh, no, no, no. He loves us no matter what. He shapes us into the form of Christ because that makes us better and it makes our lives better. And so today, what God's going to give you is the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is going to help you to be shaped into the shape of Christ, to live in a way that makes your life better. And God's going to be there every second of the way with you. And he will never, ever, ever give up on you. Ever. No matter what, Aylin. So do you believe that Jesus Christ came to earth? He's the Son of God. That he died to forgive your sins. And after 3 days he rose again from the grave.
Yes, I do.
Then you can go ahead and plug your nose. I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins. Happy birthday. You're brand new.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcomed with open arms, praise God. Just as I am, just as I am, I would be lost. But mercy and grace my freedom bought, And now to glory in your cross, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God. Just as I am, praise God. Just as I am.
Yeah, everybody's talking about the boomers, millennials, and Gen Z. People talk generations and they mention those three. Our kids call us boomers. No, that's incorrect. We have our own name. It is Generation Z.
Well, praise the Lord. It's been a great day. I have to say, yesterday was my wife's birthday. Now, Jim, 6 years ago, I got in trouble for telling her age. But I won't tell her age today. Thank you, Marilyn, for being the wife that you've been, for being the mother that you've been, for being the friend that you've been. I love you. The angels in heaven are rejoicing right now, aren't they, Gene? That's what the Word of God says. They're having a good time. They've written your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Praise the Lord Jesus. You know, it's going to be a great day. We get to heaven, and the Lord says, Judy Lyles, Well, there she is. Come on in. Come on in. Oh, what a time that's going to be. Live the best life that you can live. That's a given. That's your given. And then when you need help, ask the Holy Spirit of God to reach down real deep and pick you up and let's go. And you'll make a difference in this life. You'll make a difference that God will, oh, he'll wrap his loving arms around you. Go with God and thank you.